we welcome Thomas Haas to the BC Restaurant Hall of Fame.
Thank you for having me, and I do think there's some chefs missing who are in the annual general meeting, but it keeps a little bit of tight and a young crowd I see here. Lots of juniors coming to, or from Edmonton. I better say nothing about the Canucks. So when Dawn asked me if I would come and do something for the chefs conference, and I said, of course. And we were debating, should I make a demo or should I, you know, there was between 45 minutes to an hour time. And my experience was when I was teaching on World Pastry Championships or whatsoever, and we would do lots of demos and desserts, what the chefs wanted to see, new techniques and things. I also learned that most of them, what they really wanted, they want to know more about in between the lines, you know. So we would start making a demo of something, and all of a sudden questions would come in, and we would completely veer off of the topic of making this dessert, and we would talk about, you know, probably the thought process, how it comes to the desserts, and then we would actually go as far as, how did you start your career, and what got you into it, and And I thought the most important thing when I come today, it's like, who cares about the recipes? It's about having some food being shared here. So I brought a few hundred of our chocolates with me for you, so you will have, after lunch, you will have your dessert here. So the main thing there was, then I felt like the interest was so much on, you know, what gets you where you are and what got you there, and I think that's a common, we see this nowadays, that there's such an interest from people if you go through Twitter and Facebook and all those things, where we want to know more about that person, and myself the same. If I go on a conference and I hear somebody speak, and I hear them speaking in an inspiring way because what they have done in the past and what they have created was of true interest, and sometimes we only see the facade, you know, we just see them. For us in this case, we have a business, and now we have two stores and we work with 40 people, and you come and join us, that's all you see, but you probably don't see what it took to get there, and what the efforts were, and what probably the luck is of getting there, and how you can create your own luck. When I came here, as the little video said, obviously I'm a little bit single-minded of being born and raised in a pastry family. My father, my grandfather, my great-grandfather were on that. So as a 16-year-old at that time, there was never the question of, oh, what am I going to do? Should I become a pilot, or should I work for the city? Or it was like, no, you're going to go into pastry school, and I'm going to find a place for you to work, and this is the hardest chef I could find for you, because you need it. And so my father set myself up, and at that time I never talked back, you know, so I'm like, okay. And he sold it to me also in a way that, like, oh, and one day you're going to go on a cruise ship and you explore the world, and then you come back in the Black Forest and you take the little cafe over. So he sent me away and I never came back. And so I became of, well, it took a while. I became of the kind of the black sheep. I felt that way for a long time. But once you explore the world and once you challenge yourself and you realize how much it makes you feel good of being all on your own and getting things thrown at you, often getting pushed in the corner and then bounce back and try to come out stronger, you know, it shapes your character. And I think you source a lot of that. And in the earlier days, like when I went, I think it was still easier because you're 16, you're still getting molded, you know. Nowadays, often we go into our careers, make careers change in the mid-20s or in the late-20s. And so I think you have to be a little bit more delicate. But at that time, I got whacked, you know. I was like, oh my God, probably have to show the other side. So I get whacked there too, and then I go back to work. And and there was on this chef's induction of the Hall of Fame, I was asked to bring some memorabilia. And one of the memorabilia, which I still have, was an apple peeler. And I love that story because I think it really it must have shaped subconsciously my career significantly. And the story started off something like this. My first day at work at the master chef's place far away from home, so I moved away in the age of 16 with my moped, and I settled in and went to bed, and I remember clearly I could not fall asleep. I was so nervous. I don't think excited. So I was so nervous, and eventually I did fall asleep at 4 o'clock in the morning and did not hear the alarm, and somebody runs up, apprentice, knocks on my door, "You must be Thomas in there, you slept in, what the hell is going on?" And I'm like, oh my god, I'm running down. I had no recollection how to button my jacket, and was the old-fashioned jacket where you put the buttons in, and I was so confused. Go down there, go in the kitchen, apologize 10 times, I'm like, "Chef, what do you want me to do?" And they said, "Well, you go as an apprentice, you go in the corner, and you start peeling apples and preparing the fruits of the day." It was late summer, fall season. So I'd be there, and I see like cases of fresh plums and Boscombe apples, and so they give me this apple peeler, and I take this apple peeler and look at it, and I said, "Jesus, I don't know how to use this damn thing." So it was one for being right-handed, and I'm left-handed. So anything I do left-handed. And so I'm sitting there, and I'm standing there, and I'm looking, and I said, like, talk to one of the girls, her name was Andrea. So like, "Have you ever another apple peeler, like one I can use like this, you know, with the blade in the middle?" And she said, "No, that's the only apple peeler we have." And said, "I'm left-handed, I can't do it, you know." And so he heard it, and he came around, and he said, "What did I just hear?" And I said, like, "Chef, I'm sorry, I just was asking if you have another set of apple peelers because I'm left-handed." "What? You're left-handed? That, no, nobody told me ever that, you know, if I would have known, you know, I have people with university degree lining out the door to get a job, and then I hire a left-handed guy. What the hell is going on?" And he was the gentleman, the fellow. He had, I think, don't quote me, but in the mid-40s, he had 2 heart attacks already, and one of them strokes? Heart attacks? Heart attacks, you're dead, no? Strokes is still alive. So anyways, those things when you go like, and he sits on the thing and he gets pale, and the ambulance comes and takes him, and so he was extreme in his demeanor, and but he was a genius in what he did, you know, and I still respect him for that, you know. But he also went into your head a lot, you know, which I don't respect really, because as a youngster, you really can get a little, you know, crazy about it because you can't sleep for nights and stuff. So it went into my head, and I had this thing, and I was flustered all day, went back up at night, told myself, "Damn it, I'm going to go down." Went down at 4 o'clock in the morning, start peeling apples. We started at 6. Did it the second day, and I think after the third day, guaranteed I was as fast or faster than the fastest apprentice in the kitchen. You know, because I just did not want to face that kind of thing anymore. And if I look back at that time, you just think that's what you have to do in order of not to drown. And at the end, I think it does do a significant change in you, where it shapes you of saying, like, "Damn it, whatever I'm going to do in my life, I just want to do the best, you know? And no matter what it is, you know, even if I have a setback, I'm going to bounce back, and I want to do the best." So I went through the apprenticeship, which went better and better, and he still went into everybody's head once in a while. And I visited him 2 years ago, and so he sold his shop because nobody wanted it, his kids didn't want to do it, and now he has this mad scientist chocolate kitchen in the basement. It's true, and I imagined it because I heard from our chocolate company who provides our enrobing belt, which is from Germany. He said, like, "You gotta go there, the guy's genius, but he's crazy." And I said, like, "I know." So, and I pictured that because this kitchen was 25 years ago, was on the standard good kitchens are nowadays. We had, for everything what we did, we had a piece of equipment. Nothing was missing. Plums got pitted automatically, cherries got pitted automatically, apples got peeled by a young guy automatically, you know. So there was, like, he was very well equipped, and again, you know, I have a kind of admiration for that. And so I went, and I wanted to visit him because his daughter sent me an email that he's following us a little bit on our website, and he's so proud, and blah, blah, blah. And I visit him, and there he is, and he's like 76 now or something, and really you could see that the years worn him down a little bit, and I went down into his mad scientist's kitchen, and here he develops an enrobing belt where he can make truffles. They dust themselves, and the dust falls then into, I think, in a vacuum, a touchstone from a vacuum, sucks up the dust and blows it through a channel up on the other side and puts it back into the container. So he recycles that, and he makes cocoa dust of truffles by himself, you know, and it's amazing, you know, it's inspiring. So anyways, after that, after those 3 years of apprenticeship, I stayed there for another year. I don't know why, but I just thought I need to have a little bit more of that hardcore kind of experience. And then I spread my wings, and I thought, like, okay, I need to travel now. And it's a common thing for probably a lot of you want to do your apprenticeship or your junior kitchen time, that you want to learn. And what I can advise, you just want to learn from the best you can find, you know, if that is a part of your goal. You know, I think the biggest accomplishment for human when it comes, I think not just career but life, is if you once answered your question of who you are and what you want to be, you are further than most people in this world. Because most of us, you know, they never really understand who we are really and where do we want to go. You know, and that doesn't matter what it is, I think. It doesn't matter if you have the ambition to become flying on the moon, or you just want to make the most beautiful muffin in the world. It does not matter, but as long as you know that, hey, for me, baking a muffin, and I know it's, and that's all I want to do, or make wedding cakes, and that's all I want to do, but that's what I feel like, you know, if you know that, and if you know that, hey, I'm not the person who wants to work in a 3-star Michelin restaurant, even if it sounds good, or I'm not the person who wants to run a pastry shop with 20 or 30 people or take big risks or whatever, then I think you are well on your way, and you will find happiness, I think, and you'll find satisfaction, and you will get great recognition too, not just from customers or whoever you, I think from your friends and from your family, you know. And that answer to that question, I think, is not easy to find, you know, because, you know, we don't ask ourselves that many times. I often come in that situation where when you build a business, people ask me, how did you start, you know, and I said, like, well, I just get up every morning and I want to do the best I can do, and that's my goal. So working from one place to another and trying my best, and then I thought, like, well, so, and then I went to pastry school in Germany when you have 3 or 4 years of additional experience as a pastry cook afterwards, so you have 6 to 7 years, you can go to master school. And master school means you get your papers in business and pastry. So you go for a year to school, and without those papers, you cannot run your own business in Germany. So you need that. You get educated in, you know, from psychology to accounting to business administration, and then all the practical things you get tested on, that you are on that certain level. And I did it when I was 22, and the place I worked, where I took a break from, he asked me, and that was the first experience for me as a youngster working with a chef who actually was generous. You know, I went through that hardcore schooling of where you're good for nothing, and you should just go over every day, and it was rigid, hard work. It was not never ever the experience of the beauty of creating food, you know, the pleasure you give other people, and the fun doing so. It was like, boom, this is what's going to be, and this is how you have to follow it. And you creating this, you ate actually what was made yesterday or 2 days ago. So that was the kind of, and then I came to this shop, and the chef I met there, I said, if I can work for a few days, which I recommend to everyone, I said, like, I went there 3-4 times as a customer, looked at it, felt like, oh my God, I felt in my stomach, I love what I see, and I would just love to work there. And I went there, and I went there again, and went there again, and then one day I gave my papers in, and he said, you look familiar, I saw you every day this week. You know, I said, like, yeah, sorry, I drove down from Stuttgart to Karlsruhe, it was 100 kilometers, and I said, I just came for coffee and cake in the afternoon. And he said, like, oh my God. So he looked at the resume and said he doesn't have an opening right now, and said, that's okay. And then 2 months later, he called me back and said, like, we got a big contract from a pharmaceutical company for Christmas, and we could really need somebody, and would you be interested? So I started there and worked there for a year, had a great time, and I never experienced that a chef would come. And you know, at the end of the days, often when the kitchen shuts down, I would stay and I would say, like, you know, I know we need, it's Easter time, we need, in Germany, marzipan is a big thing, and the art of marzipan modeling and airbrushing is still popular, from fruits to animals. And there was this book which I still admire from a Swiss guy, which is called Freddy Eggenschwiler. Any Swiss in the house here? Any Vancouver people here? Oh, so here you go. Oh, that's very international. So anyway, so it was this, those marzipan artists, and I was inspired by that, and I would stay after work and I'd say, like, is it okay if I just make 200 of those? Because I know making one doesn't make me a master, you know, but making 200 4 days in a row, that probably gets me better at doing. And we teach that nowadays at our shop on a daily basis, you know, when we have somebody going on to the croissant station, I say, like, make the croissants, and you make it for 3 months, you are not a master yet. But if you make it for 6 or 9 months, and you can make it blindfolded, and one is like the other, and you can see that, you know, if they pull the dough and they roll it tight, and each one looks the same, and they get the feel for it, that the flour is a little different, the temperature was colder because it's 8 degrees outside instead of 22, so that they can test the gluten, that's what makes you a master. And once you have that experience, nobody can ever take that from you. You know, there's like, it's like you have it in your pocket, but anything else would be, oh, I touched it, I made it, and you leave, and you know nothing afterwards. And so I offered myself if I could, you know, just stay. And he said, like, yeah, sure, stay. And I would choose one of the things, and I would make them, and I would make 200 of it, and come back the next day and airbrush them, and then the third day I would put the eyes on and put them together. And I just felt like that's the best way for my... What would I do? I would sit in my little rental apartment at home at night, watch TV. Oh, I better do this and get pleasure out of it. And at the end, apparently, it made me better at what I was doing. And so he would come around, and one night he would put his arm around me and say, like, you know, do you want to go for dinner with us? And I'm like, I don't know. I would have to go home. No, you come upstairs to take a shower there, and then we go. And I'm like, okay. So he would take me out for dinner in a one-star Michelin restaurant. And I could not read a thing. I had no idea what I do with all this cutlery and those wine glasses. So I was sitting there and I was guided. And I was like, okay, this is what it is. I got to order. And then we share everything what we have. And it was an amazing experience, which somehow truly inspired me of, you know, that there's so much beauty in food and connection and things with what connects us. So it's not just the hard work which goes in it. There is a lot of rewards with it. And I fell a kind of, in love, not with him, but with being actually, you know, opened up and being offered something like this. And so I went to master school. He asked me to come back and be his pastry chef. And I'm like, I don't know. I'm 22 years old and I don't think he's 56 and he's to bake and he's going to give me shit. You know? And he says, no, you will be fine. You just come back. And he's like, okay, I go to school and then you tell me later. And so I went to school, worked Saturdays in the shop and did my thing there and came back as pastry chef. And he did a big renovation in between that to set up his store for his son who just started apprenticeship. And I was there for a year and another year and almost 2 years. And I was exhausted. You know, I just was, now I would say I was too young. You know, I was too young of experience, of, I think, people skills, of, even though he would constantly say, I know, you do a great job, you know, I just felt like with 22, you can't be ready, or 23 by then. But I did it, and a friend of mine said, like, okay, you got to leave, you look like shit, you look tired, your eyes are in there, and so look for something else. And we spoke, and I said, look, I think I need to do something else. I don't think I'm the best I can be, and it's a big job, and there were 13 people in the pastry kitchen at that time. So I decided to go to Switzerland and go somewhere else and go into, I'm from Germany originally, so go into 5-star hotels, and I haven't experienced that, so I've never done a plated dessert in my life, and I've never done an ice buffet and carvings and stuff like that. So I thought, like, well, that's a good challenge. So I started at a 2-star Michelin hotel restaurant in the Black Forest on my days off while I was negotiating what would be the best departure, which is another big thing. You know, I think whenever you work for somebody or with somebody, you know, I think there's the thing of honor, and we experienced that a lot when we had a girl with us in Chocolates for 7 years, and she would come to me last year and said, like, look, I know eventually I need a change, you know, but she wouldn't come 2 weeks before and say, like, oh, sure, I'm leaving, you know. She would be like, you know, probably I want to do something else next year. And I said, like, oh, next year? Yeah, I know it's, I've never worked so long at one place, like I worked here, but I need, she's very creative, and, you know, and that's an honor, you know. It's like, for me, you know, I just go on my knees when I feel that somebody has that much respect and gives you that much respect in planning their own future. And so I departed slowly there and moved to Switzerland and started in the hotel, new challenge, got my all adults, so I got my ass kicked. And a few times, you know, we had an Austrian chef there, and it was tough, but was also good, and I actually loved the challenge, and did that for a couple of years, and then I moved one mountain chain over to St. Moritz and did the same thing. I had one girl working with me, she said, like, oh, there's the best restaurant in Switzerland, it's over there, let's drive there. So we drove there 3 or 4 nights in a row and had dinner there. I was completely broke afterwards. It was spread between 2 weeks. And then I said, that's the place, I think I gotta go there. So I chose again a place which I thought, I have to admit, I was lucky, it was always in a cool town, you know. So there was skiing and there was some bars and there was, you know. But I did find the best place there could be, and I would go there, and I made them a cake, and I put a blown sugar piece on top. And I said, that's for the kitchen. And once the owner offered me a job, and apparently I didn't see it, the kitchen chefs were so, I don't know what it is, they put their fist in, and they went right into the cake, you know. And I don't know what kind of expression it was, but they told me, you know what we did with your cake? You know, we said, like, you're going to get that German guy, get him in, and we show him, and they put the fist in the cake and turn the fist in. Whatever. So that was a good start there. And I met the chef, like the chef owner was stepping backwards a little bit and had his chef in there. And I looked at him, it was like top-notch 2-star Michelin restaurant in the middle of St. Moritz or a little bit outside. And I meet the chef, and I, like, he had like 2 or 3 fingers left. And he had, you know, front business, back party look. So short hair here, long hair here, tattoos everywhere. And I'm like, okay, that can't be. My father would, like, so I met him, and I was I don't want to disrespect anyone of saying this was the best chef, because then the other one, which I'd love to work with as well, so it was one of the best chefs I've ever worked with. And getting to know him, he was also one of those hardcore, and I got to know, so he lost his fingers when he was 24, not knowing what he's going to do with his life, and he was so stoned working in a sawmill. And got up in the morning, go to work, and cut his fingers off. And then he said, like, forget it, I gotta become a chef. And he went to chef school, and he became one of Switzerland's best chefs, bar none. He was dedicated and was hardcore, and he was a team guy. You know, he would, but a team guy on the on the tough side. So we would all live in those little apartments across the street. And his way of getting up in the morning, so the shift would start at 7:30, we would prepare for lunch, and then we get a 2-hour break, and then we prepare for dinner. So in the summertime at 4 o'clock, he would get everybody out of bed and say, like, okay, let's get on the bikes, let's go and watch the sunrise. And we're like, are you crazy? And he's like, oh, everybody. So everybody had to go on their mountain bikes, go up to the peaks and watch the sunrise and have a glass of champagne and then go to work. And so... So it was pretty interesting, and from there, that's another reflection of that sometimes you don't know, you know, you don't need to be afraid of not knowing where you want to go. Sometimes it just happens to be, I think, if you set your path right throughout your career and trying to do the best you can do. So going from there, we had a chef's, it was called the St. Moritz Gourmet Festival, and they invited 10 chefs from around the world, the tourism of St. Moritz, and they would cook in all those luxurious hotels, and then they do a big dinner on the frozen lake where all 10 worldwide chefs come in, and they would cook for the millionaires and blah blah blah, and it was like this big event, you know. And so I met the chef from the Four Seasons Hotel in Chicago, and they would come to the restaurant, have dinner, and then they would say like, "You have to come with us." And he was Swiss too, the general manager. "You have to come with us to Chicago." And I'm like, "Wow, I want to go to North America, learn the language," and had the kind of North American dream as a young fellow. And I would say, "Sure." And as I went, "Well, next month we get you the paper." And I said, "Oh, I can't do this. I just gonna cut my legs off over there." And so we negotiated that I would do it for the next season, and had talks back and forth, long story short. Didn't hear from them all of a sudden. I said, "Well, we're just not good enough." No, what happened is they couldn't get the visa, and then the Four Seasons in Vancouver called, and I got a ticket and the stuff within 2 weeks. And here we go. I was coming down and landing in Vancouver, and that was in 1995. And yeah, I had never been, when you come from Europe, it's not, you know, you go to other countries, you rather get a little bit looked at like this, you know. So you come here and I felt like completely different. You come to Canada and all of a sudden you feel like people, you know, they greet you with open arms. And I came in a company which was very well organized, and so it touched my soul a little bit, I would say, and I got a little soft there, and embraced it, I would say, and started there. And my promise to my father was I go for a year and then I come back, and then I got 2 years. And one of the pastry cooks in the kitchen, he would, he's still a good friend of mine, and he's not here, but he's a chef, still at the Four Seasons at times, when he gets excited, then he stutters a little bit, you know, we all laugh about it with him, you know, so he wouldn't be mad at me, but he would say like, "Oh, Thomas, look at this girl, she is really, she would be so perfect for you." And I'm like, "Oh, don't worry about it." And so anyways, I met my wife Lisa in the hotel there because of Gerhard. Because he would constantly pull me on the side and say like, no, I said, "No, I have to go back to Germany in a year from now." And he said, no, "Yeah, you guys have to go out together." And so it ended up, and it was 2 years and 3 years, and we got married and had a baby on the way, and then I got this. I exposed myself. I exposed myself to the cooking society out there, you know. So the first thing was like, I wanted to know who is the best pastry chef in the country, like in the US and in Canada. And there was a couple within the company, and I looked them up and I got in contact with them. I just needed some excitement and flew to Chicago and stashed with one of the best pastry chefs I've ever met. They have the French pastry school now. So if you ever want to go and take a rock solid class in pastry, the French pastry school in Chicago is the place to be. And I went there and I saw what he was doing, and worked there for a couple of weeks for free in my vacation. And they were preparing for this big American Pastry Chef of the Year competition in New York. And he was training his assistant, who also became later on a friend of mine. And so she would prepare, and I would see her and go, "Wow, I should do that, because I'm not a believer in competition in general, and I wasn't used to it, you know. But I think if you have a good foundation and you are a good cook, that's a way you can expose yourself to others." Is there another word for it? Oh, that's right, no? Okay. Whew. So you can expose yourself, and And yeah, you can get your competitive side trained and refreshed for that. And so I said, oh yeah, I would like to do it. When is it? And he said, like, oh, this one, forget about it. This is in 2 months, but you can do it for next year. And I said, like, 2 months? What? That's far away. And he said, are you crazy? You got to prepare. She prepares for the last year for it. And I like, okay. So I went back, wrote him a letter, and they still took applications. And they choose, I think they choose a kind of who they know and what they think would be interesting. And there's lots of New York chefs doing that. And they invited me, and I'm like, oh, there's only 7 weeks to go. So, and I'm sending this email to Chicago, and said, oh, what should I do now? And they said, like, you're crazy. There's, you can't do it. You have to prepare for a year. And I said, oh, forget. Anybody who knows me a little bit knows the more I'm in trouble time-wise, the better I actually seem to perform. So so I would go and prepare myself and go with the skills I had and go to New York, check in the hotel there, ask the pastry chef if I could have a little kitchen space, obviously in advance. And here she was, and Ming, she also won the World Coupe du Monde pastry chef competition in Lyon, with the Bocuse is afterwards, and then the Coupe du Monde is before, which is the most prestigious competition in our field, I would say. There's the American World Pastry Championships, which are great too. But anyways, the Lyon one in France, if you ever want to travel, do what I do every 2 years. I go 3 days to Paris, 3 days to Lyon, you know, and then I'm set for the next 9 months of being just pumped up and see so many new things. So we would go, so to the hotel, and she would work here, and I would work in my corner all by myself. I had my box of tools and brought everything with me, and here she is with boxes big as the table and an assistant and a compressor. And so I looked around the corner and I saw stuff, and I'm like, oh my God, now I realize probably I'm probably not ready for it. And there was some techniques I've never seen, and it was good work and kind of intimidating. So they had a van organized, and I'm like in the New York cab with my centerpiece half accomplished, my cake in the box, my dessert plate on the left, you know, driving through New York City on the cab, and every pothole, you're like, oh, it's not gonna work. And then I come in there, and everybody would have assistants, microwaves put in when they started assembling, and I'm there with my box and trying to get things done, and I'd get them assembled. And as it turned out to be, she placed first, and it was well deserved, and I was lucky to place second. And I'm only saying this because I think, you know, it makes the kind of common sense of where those steps, you know, as little as you know about, they all lead one to another if you look back. And eventually, after 3 years being in Vancouver, Danielle Boulou, who I used to be, I became his pastry chef in his new flagship restaurant in New York. And that decision I also made fully out of my gut feeling, you know. Like, I had no intention of leaving Vancouver or the hotel. I was pulled in between, should I move back to Germany? Do I belong to Vancouver? So it was probably the right thing to be somewhere in the middle and finding my answer, you know, probably cutting off my umbilical cord to my parents and say, like, okay, this is it, I'm gonna stay, you know. And New York was right in the middle, and speaking to the chef there, and somebody might have to give me signage at dawn if I have to wrap up, then you go like this, and I'm like, okay. And that's the end of the story. Hockey night in Canada. Yeah. Yeah, so I would go and talk to him on the phone, and he says, well, I'm looking for a non-French pastry chef, because the two of them, they got, like, his pastry chef was the most famous at that time, François Paillard, if that says anything to you. If you're not in the pastry field, probably not, but he had this beautiful pastry shop after he left Danielle, and so I was supposed to replace him, but he wasn't sure if I'm the guy. So, and I sent him menus and pictures, and he said, like, I'm still not sure. How about you fly down and we do a tasting, and then if you like it, that's good. I pay for the expenses, and if not, we share them. And I said, that's fair enough. By the end of the week, he wanted a whole menu of 10 desserts, 10 petits fours, chocolates, The desserts, all different styles, from home style, something homey, something frozen, something hot, something cold, something as tasting desserts, and it just, the list went bigger and bigger, and I arrived there, and that story would fill an afternoon, but I got put in a corner, and New York cooking is different than anything I've seen before. When I would read all the magazines always, and they would say, Le Donadin restaurant covers a night, 480, and I'm like, restaurant, 480, pastry cooks, 13 in the kitchen, menus, dessert menus, 22, and I'm like, that can't be in a restaurant, you know, so I wasn't used to those numbers, and but that's what it is, and then real estate is tight there, so you basically, you get that much space to work on, and so that's what I was pushed in the corner, so like, here's your space, you're going to work on it, did like the 24-hour straight from the plane, go in the corner, make relation, a good contact with the guy in the espresso machine, and started preparing my mise en place, and kept on going all day. It was Friday night until Saturday, all Saturday afternoon, and then when service started, I started plating the first dessert, the second dessert, and Danielle would go, you know, and you hear a screaming in the kitchen. And that's another thing I could talk, you know, like we see those TV shows, Gordon Ramsay, and it's made for TV, but there's, I can testify, there's a lot of reality in it too, you know, and I think it depends how we perceive that reality. Like when I was in New York, it was entertainment pure, you know, it was like there would be waiters pulled over the station, there would be young cooks only, and I'm not making this up, there would be young cooks there would be young cooks being at the rotisserie, and all of a sudden all you see is the checker there, you know, and the guy is gone, you know, and so there was such an, yeah, there was a checker and an apron, and you thought like he probably just evaporated, but he was gone, you know, and it happened all the time, and I thought we were really sane in the pastry kitchen, dealing with that pressure and that craziness, and the chef Alex Lee, which you saw on one of the pictures, he was great, but the way he dealt with the pressure, including Daniela, he would pull the waiter over and he would shake him and say, "You don't just sing everybody to the table," you know. The guy could not carry a plate anymore, but that was the way it was dealt with. In service was over, everybody had a glass of wine, talked about it, you know, and the next day it started again. So for me, that was the biggest lesson, never take anything personal, you know, and so I had lots of discomfort at the beginning because I wasn't used, as much as I was promised from St. Moritz that there will be no place harder than there. So I went to New York and said, "You lied to me," because this was much harder and crazier. And but I got used to it, and I really put an effort into understand, and that depends on the person you work with. You know, you can have an idiot screaming and you don't respect him. But if you know if somebody screams at you and sends you that message, but the only motivation to do that is because he truly cares about what's going on from here to there, and nothing else really matters at that moment, you know, then you don't take it personal, you know. And so I felt I my biggest lesson was Danielle couldn't teach me how to make desserts, but he would tell me what tastes good and what doesn't taste good, you know, and he couldn't teach me any techniques, but he would teach me how to keep up standards and how to never take anything personal. There was a situation where I came in on the French president was there and for lunch with his wife and a delegation, and he wanted a menu and he wanted me to see what I do for him, and we were so busy for lunch and I had no time to write it down. And he has this kitchen skybox office when he's not on the pass, and he would press the CEO button and say like, "Thomas! What's going on? I need the menu." And it was like, okay. And I'm going back and I don't have time right now, but soon. You know, and people are going, and I was like, eventually the staircase was full with waiter, maitre d', another waiter, another maitre d', and they would stand there and ask for things. And I'm like, okay, no, it's time, I better go up. So I had my little paper, go up the stairs, and I hear him like saying, "You know, the fucking guy down there." Sorry, I normally don't use swear words, but this was the words I saw. "The guy down there, I asked him, and as you know that, and he would swear," and I'm standing right there, and then I repeated it, and that deep guy is here, and here's the menu, you know. And so I gave it to him. I went down, and you went through, and I came back on Sunday to do a private wedding. And he put his arm around me and said, like, I'm so sorry, I didn't want to insult you, and blah, blah, blah. And I said, like, if I would have taken it ever personal, you know, I would have been long gone. You know, you are under so much pressure. There's so much on your plate. All you wanted is something I couldn't deliver at that time for my reason, you know. So there's no question. You know, I never felt that way. And I think it keeps you free internally. You know, and those are the things you don't necessarily get taught, and those are the things you don't necessarily learn often in the kitchen, because, you know, we do get caught up in ourselves, and we do get caught up in, like, I've just been treated badly or whatever. But no, it never really mattered. And I really put an effort in of thinking that way, and I think it sets you free on the inside, because it allows you to stay focused. So that New York time was the best years of my professional career, I would say, because they were the most demanding, challenging, and the most learning, in a sense, too, how somebody never ever lets go on anything, you know? Like, he couldn't always be there, and at that time it was only Daniel, the restaurant, and his old Café Boulou. But it was, the guy would fly to Paris, and he would be in the airplane and send a text or call and wants to see the reservation list. And not that he's a control freak, but he was always there. Even if he was millions of miles away, his spirit was always there. And I think there's something, you know, I think that lives on in a sense, and that stays with us. And you said, like, hey, no matter what, I just want to do it. Even now when he's away, I want to do even better. And so those experiences are invaluable, and nobody can ever take that from you. And how to get to those is, you know, by do what I feel I've done of getting up in the morning, try to do the best I can do, and then move on. So we decided to come back to Vancouver, wrap this up a little bit faster after 2.5 years. And I told him a year in advance, I said, like, no other 3-year visa for me. There was a 2-year, and then there would have been a 3-year. We had a second baby, and I felt this is really where we want to be. We really want to be here. I let you know, but I stay with you as long as you want me to. You know, so stayed another 6 months, then another 2 months, until then we got a French guy in, and we trained him. He came from Plaza Athénée in Paris, and then it was the fall of 2000, and so it was 98, 99, 2000. At the end of 2000, I came back here, and was lucky again, I think, in a sense that somebody approached me to, if I would be interested in opening a pastry shop for him, which is the Metropolitan Hotel, and it was called Five Senses, and at the same time I could start making chocolates on my own business, which coincidentally happened to be because the chocolates they had in their plan were just, and they came from New York, and they were just bad. And I said, like, well, we can do better, so how about I buy the equipment, I do them, and I sell them to you, and then I'd be your pastry chef throughout the day for the hotel and for the pastry shop. And those were those years where you get up at 7 in the morning, no much different than New York, but ride your bike to the city, work until 7 at night, and then have a dinner, then go into your little chocolate kitchen, which was the size of the stage here, everything included, and you make chocolates and until 4 in the morning, and then you sleep 3-4 hours, and that's no exaggeration. Sometimes we would leave at 1 o'clock, or I had one girl with me, and then we had 2 girls. We were working together, and we listened to radio stations where there was people calling in. I don't know what they were called, but, you know, people calling in and would tell their stories, and we were laughing so hard. And chocolate making was beautiful because it was like focus on one thing. I put a little display up because I actually wanted to talk about chocolate and cocoa beans, but forget about it, no? So we would be working, and then we would start laughing. They had to stop dipping them, and so, like, did you just hear what she just said on the radio? And so it would go until 1 in the morning, and we did that for 4 years. And the way things grew there, it was word of mouth, a little bit of luck again that, you know, I worked for Four Seasons and worked in New York, and so things came together, and a lot of the chefs in the States would order our chocolates for the hotels and restaurants, and by the fourth year, we would do 25,000 pieces still by hand, and still now it's the same thing. And we would ship them, and then the girls told me, you know, we love it, but we would also love to make some desserts, and the rest is kind of history. We moved in a little bit of a bigger space, took some big risks, because I wanted to have a beautiful kitchen, and there was a couple of pictures in there. I want to have a beautiful, a great work environment for somebody, not just myself, but everybody who works there. Said like, okay, whatever it takes to make this the best place to work in, and that doesn't mean that we do have a ping pong table, but it doesn't mean hot tub and helicopter pad and stuff like this. But it means like the best equipment and good products and pride and having fun doing so. So yeah, so it grew steadily, and that was our ambition. And we shifted a little bit over the years, and from having that in the middle of nowhere shop, we did a second shop in the city, because we didn't want to do much more wholesale, which was a part of the beginning areas, the beginning stages. And that's where we are. And now our sole focus is of getting better at what we do, and focus on the details. And the details are not just on the product and the customer, but also on the people we work with, and make it the best business it can be. So that's a little bit my story. And any questions? In regards of like training somebody or being, you know, I'm a softy. It's terrible. Like, you know, sometimes I wish I could crack the whip really badly, but I think I have learned a lot, and I've calmed down a lot probably too, but I have learned a lot that, you know, there's different ways how, if I would have, I have to admit, there's two phases to it. If I would have a 16-year-old and I see there's potential, I would crack. My son is 13 now, 13 going for 7, telling the kid, but so now I said, okay, you're 13, you're going to come to work, you know. And he doesn't have the kind of mindset of work attitude or anything. So I'm actually putting people on him, like, I said, so you are in charge of him and you make sure that he's going to get. He's seeing things and he's asking for things and he's not going to be lazy, okay? My father always said, don't be lazy, son. That's all I want to know. Don't be lazy. So if there would be somebody, you know, young and 16, of course I would support them. And but I would probably use a different way than if you deal with somebody who is mature, 25, 22 or 23. I think it's very individual. When I grew up, there was no difference. You would just goes like this. Nowadays, I think you get the best out of him, of really motivating. Your name was?
Tim.
Yeah. So, you know, of encouraging him all the way, and Tim thrives on that. While Chris needs probably a little bit of more, a firmer hand to get motivated, you know. Is it true? There we go. I knew it. So I think, we try to communicate very well in the kitchen that, you know, we aim for high standards, and believe me, you never feel satisfied with that, because you always feel like we can do so much better and we have to do so much better, but it's a process, you know, it's a process, and you need people on the way. So we try to do it a kind of the buying in, I think that's a big part. You know, we had a staff meeting just before I came here, and I said that, you know, I can tell a lot of things, but unless you make it a part of yourself, it will not stick with you. You know, and that comes from learning something. Go back to the croissants, you know, say like, oh, chef, I made the croissants the last 2 months. I said like, so what? You know, that doesn't make you good at making croissants, you know, but once you master it, it actually becomes a part of you. Or having that, you know, we talk a lot about environmental, we are in a hypocritical business of, you know, conscientious of the environment, but at the same token, if not everything is packaged nice, the customer doesn't want it, and especially on the level we gonna produce and supply, in a sense. So we look at all the details and constantly push for the manufacturers we work with. If there has to be soy-based inks and post-consumer recycled paper and not from food source produced biodegradable plastic, and so all those things, I think they are useless if you just throw them in the thing. But if they become a part of your habits, then it will always stick with you. You know. So I think we work a lot on that of saying, like, I don't want you to smile when you work in retail just because you have to. You know, I want you to believe that this actually makes your day better. You know, if you have a positive approach and you are genuine and you are caring, you know, the reflection of the other side to you will be so positive that it must affect your day. It must make you feel better. You know, so thanks for having me. Yeah.